Sigh of the Storm is brought to you by Revelton Distilling Company. You can visit them in Osceola, Iowa, or on the web at www.reveltondistillery.com.
Well, see, okay, so I mean, we're gonna start this podcast off. So our question, and this is Sigh of the Storm, and you know, y'all see that, you know, we're gonna kick it off a little different. Y'all see I got a little person behind me. So the question for this, for the people out there is it daddy daycare if it's your own kids? So this is the question that I call it daddy daycare because my wife is out of town tonight. So I didn't want to cancel on us, but my wife out of town for work. She had an overnight she had to do down in Tucson. So is it called daddy daycare if it's your own kids?
Nah, what do you know? That's your responsibility.
That's it, man.
That's you.
That's you. I feel like I got daddy daycare, man. Like, man. No, but they cool as long as I don't go too long. They're like, daddy, last time you did it, I had a headache and you couldn't give me no medicine. and I couldn't bother you and I was hurting. I'm like, all right, buddy. I was like, I'll do it earlier today. Cause mom's not home, you know, and they out there and my door is closed. I don't know what they up to. You know, I fed them tacos. We had Taco Wednesday cause we didn't make it last night, but you know, it's, you know, I gotta take care of the responsibility today. So, you know, everybody welcome to Sigh of the Storm. George Trice here, Brent Curvey, Marcus Pfizer. You know, I go in alphabetical order when I can. How y'all doing today? I'm on one tonight, man.
Living the
doing
dream.
Good, absolutely. Sure. It's I don't know how it is out in the Midwest would be at, but we got good weather out here.
Man,
hey,
man.
Look, like for real, it's been in the 40s. Wow. So like,
you would heard somebody else from the Midwest say that.
We're super good right now.
I heard somebody else from the Midwest
like we straight. It was like 61 the other day or something. I was like, my son came out in shorts. I was like, I guess we chilling this week.
So, yeah. Groundhog ain't see his shadow. Let's go.
Let's get this out the way.
Oh, he didn't?
I don't know. I'm just saying 61 degrees. You know,
I never know any of that stuff. For real.
I don't know. I don't pay attention. That's the day after my birthday. I don't be paying attention to that groundhog. hold on one second.
Man, is that thing called casting a shadow?
Man, I'm going to have to get some tips from you, Pfizer. Shit, I'm doing no meat February, man. So I'm cutting meat completely out the old diet for this month. Just trying to test it out and see where it's at, but I have no idea.
How you gonna do it at work then? I mean, your business, like.
Hey, it's all about fighting that temptation, man. I'm in here every day too. I can eat the eggs. I can do all that other stuff, but I got like honestly, my favorite one is I make like a spinach mozzarella mushroom kolache. I'll definitely smash one of them, you know, one or two a day.
well, with me, all I do is just, you know, I just try to replace it, whatever kind of vegetable or whatever it is. Like, you know, if you're getting like chicken and rice, or whatever, I just get extra rice. Or if I get a burrito, you know, like if it was supposed to be like a steak burrito or whatever, I just ask for extra rice and extra pico or whatever and just go with that.
Not whiskey.
Yeah. I'm trying to figure it out, man. I'm like, I've been working out too. So I'm like, man, I'm tired all the time. I got to figure this protein out. It's like, it's some protein and some beans and all of that stuff.
Beans, things like Brussels sprouts. We eat a lot of Brussels sprouts, broccoli, stuff like that. I mean, you got to understand, like, the protein that you think you get from animals or that you get from animals, those animals actually get the proteins from the greens.
The grass.
So, you're right. So, like, that's the middleman is like, you know, half of the protein that you should be getting. If you just go directly to the source, I mean, it is what it is.
So with the plant protein, do you have a plant protein that you take, a supplement that you take?
I don't.
Whole food.
I pretty much eat whole foods. Like, you know, not eating bad, but I've always had like a case of high blood pressure since I was in high school for whatever reason. So like a lot of plant-based stuff that they make burgers and things like that have a lot of sodium in it. So I can't really get with that sodium a lot. So what I just try to do, I just try to get a lot of whole foods, fruits and things like that. There's different foods that I love, restaurants, places, and stuff like that. You know, scared to get up there to be place because I don't feel like I'm gonna like it too much. Yeah. So the pizza pit, stuff like that, the wings and stuff. So I've never been like a real food craver. So for me, I've always been the person that eats because of the fuel that I need. So for a game or whatever, just in the day. Yeah. So I can go like a long time without eating. But when it is the time that I eat, I just try to fill up on, you know, a lot of salads and things like that. I try to get a lot of greens in me before I eat anything else. And, you know, it's challenging. It's extremely challenging. First off, it is hard. But like I said, I'm not, you know, I feel like animals or whatever was put here on this earth for, you know, you have a food chain. You know, I'm not to save all of the animals on the planet and don't kill them, because, you know, the food chain is, if they were put here for humans to hunt and to have food and consumption, then I believe that if you go fall off a boat in the ocean and a shark out there, he ain't going to say, well, no, I'm not going to, you know, that's just the evolution of the food chain. Like I said, when I'm back home with my dad and he have venison and wild boar and stuff like that in the freezer, that's a little different. I would eat that because it's a cleaner food, but a lot of the processed meats and stuff like that, I've been trying to stay away from a long time. So that's the basis of what I do. Just try to fill up on a lot of greens before I eat something else.
See, I know when I go like to Brazilian steakhouses, like Fogo de Chão and stuff like that, stay Brazil, I stay away from that middle salad bar. That salad bar huge. I stay away from that because I don't want to fill up on the salad. I want to get meat sweats. I want
to get all that meat.
Yeah. I know, I got to get the meat sweats. So I'm trying to change up on that because, you know, again, Brent, I've been back in the gym again. COVID took it out of me. I used to be up at 5 o'clock in the morning at the YMCA by 5:15, get my 45 to an hour workout in, go home, start my day. Everything was good. And ever since COVID, I don't want to get out that bed, man. And it's like, I'm getting up later and later, like 6 o'clock, you know, 6:15, like 6:30. I'm like, man, I got to get to bed. And so I'm trying to get my body back into what I was doing pre-COVID. And it's been harder because my breathing's still not right. Honestly, I got COVID in November of 2020, and my breathing still ain't right. And so it's just, you know, I try to get back in there because I got to. Me and the wife, it's like, I turned 43 on last Wednesday. And I got my weights sit up here in my office. I'm 272.3.
I said point three.
I was that on my January 31st. Right now I'm at 270.4. So I've lost 2 pounds already by going back to the gym already. Like not eating them, like curbing them cravings, because I got a lot of snacks in the house because I got young kids, and it's curbing those cravings and replacing those with the better stuff.
Well, one of the things that I do, I do intermittent fasting, you know, and that's really, if somebody tell you that's not tough, it is tough. It's tough, especially when you first start doing it. It's really, really tough. But, you know, my window is typically about 9:30 or 10 o'clock in the morning to 7 at night. And I try my best. I mean,
that's my window.
Not all the time I don't, right. Not all the time I don't follow it, because I try not to not go to sleep without getting some, but if I pass that 7 o'clock window, then I try to make whatever I'm going to eat be as healthy as possible. You know, something, a green salad or something like that. Because if I eat the wrong thing, man, when I wake up in the morning, my head is just banging at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. So if you can get into the intermittent fasting, and then they say in that window, you can eat whatever you want to eat. Yeah. I still try to take in that window to eat as best as I can. And when you eating the right foods, the proper foods, it's going to give you the fuel that you need, and you're not going to be that hungry. Like when it comes down to my closing window, going into the fast, sometimes I got to force myself to eat. And sometimes I'd be like, well, I'm cool or whatever. Man, about 2:30, 3 o'clock in the morning, boredom, hunger pains wake me up. And I, you know, then I get up and down some water or whatever and just, you know, watch TV for a little bit, end up falling back to sleep. But when I get up at 5:30 in the morning, like getting the kids ready and stuff for school, man, I'm watching that clock for 9 o'clock, boy, watching it hard. So then I go and get me a workout in, a little quick workout in before I get ready to take them to school, get my protein shake. I always try to break my fast with some kind of fruit or some kind of greens, you know, because that's That's the word breakfast, breaking the fast. And so something like that, some greens or fruit, and then the rest of my day is fine. But man, if I fall off that wagon that day or whatever, I can tell immediately it's gonna be a long night.
See, I thought I was doing good because my intermittent fasting starts at 10 p.m. and it goes to 7 a.m. when I wake up. So when I'm sleeping, I'm not eating. So that's what I look at as my intermittent. No. I'm playing.
I was like, that's a little backwards.
Right. Hey,
man, you know, I didn't eat nothing from 10 to 7. But I've heard good things about that. And I had a guy that did that at work, and he would do the like he sipped bone broth most of the day. That was his like throughout the day, he was drinking like bone broth because that was okay to drink that as a like kind of a supplement type thing. But
what during on the outside of his window?
Yeah. No, during his window.
During his fast or during his eating time?
During his fast. So as a liquid, he would do water and bone broth. That's what he was doing. I don't know.
There's a lot of vitamins and nutrients and whatnot in the bone broth.
Yeah. But I'm wondering why he's doing his like fasting window while he's like awake. Like do your eating during the day and then just start your fasting at night before you. I mean, it's easier. It is easier to be asleep. Yeah. While part of that, you know, fasting time. If you have your fast, if you don't start your fast at like 12 or 3 o'clock and then you end it at like 6 or, man, that's a long fast. And some people do it. Some people like have like just a 4-hour window. Yeah. I ain't at that level right now. You should have checked on me when I was in my 20s. In my 40s, it ain't about to happen.
Nah. I do. I go 18-6. I kind of go between 18-6 and 16-8. Yeah. So it'll just depend. I eat it from 10 to 6, or I'll move it to 12 to 6, kind of depending on really my day.
I got an app. It's called Simple. And, you know, I got reminders of when to drink and stuff and all that stuff. So pretty good.
No doubt. Well, hey, I got the West Virginia game on in the back, but we're going to take a break real quick, and we're going to play we're going to support our sponsor, Revelton. So we're doing something a little bit differently. I'm going to, you know, start to show our sponsor some love. So we're going to do a little different. So I'm going to play their ad for there. So, hey, thanks to Revelton for supporting us. And, hey, take this ad break and listen to Revelton. Yes,
at Revelton Distilling Company, everyone has become a part of the Revelton family. From the tailors and their daughter who helped perfect their award-winning gins, to the team who installed Lucy, our 33-foot-tall custom-made still, right down to the local farms that provide our coveted corn, and even the cows on those farms who consume our mash byproduct. Want to see the farm to flask come to life? Now you can tour Lucy and find out where we take Iowa's harvest and transform it into our finest spirits. Choose between a 45-minute tour or find out even more by scheduling a VIP behind-the-scenes tour to get the taste of the full Revelton experience. You can visit them at 1400 West Clay Street in Osceola, Iowa, or find all of Revelton's award-winning spirits at any local grocery or spirits retailer.
That's what's up. So Revelton, I'm actually going to be in town. I'm going to go down there and meet those cats on the 23rd. Brent, I don't know what you're doing. I think it's Thursday night, the 23rd. Me and shit down there.
I'm here.
Okay. So we're going to go down there, have a beverage down there. I actually think one of our sister broadcast Hot Mess Happy Hour record that night. So we can actually be possibly guests on their show.
Where's that at? Where's it going
to
be at?
We're going to go down to Revelton. We're going down.
Oh, in Revelton. Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so we're going to go down there. We're going to meet Ship down there when I get in. We're going to do that. Because I got to get some bottles anyway. Because right now I'm drinking Templeton. I'm drinking a 4-year Templeton because I want to support Iowa. You know, out in Revelton yet. I can't buy it in the stores here yet. So.
What's up with the tons names?
Revelton, the Templeton. I don't know. That's crazy. But yeah, we thank them when we'll get to our Brown Dogs Farms here later. But I want to start off really by calling out Big Play. So Big Play, I heard a rumor. I saw a rumor.
Saw it.
But let's talk about it.
Lock in. Yeah.
Let's talk about it. So, you know, tell us some news that you got there, because this goes back into the legacy discussion that Marcus talked about one time before. So tell us the news you got to share about you and your fam.
Well, my son got picked up an offer from Kansas State. So I don't really mess with purple.
Sir. However, congratulations.
Appreciate it. Appreciate it. You know, I know people are like, oh man, I think somebody even commented like, yeah, purple, the color purple looks disgusting. Like crawling the red is where it's at. So like, I get it. But you know, like I always say, man, it's good to have leverage, especially in this recruiting game. So
exactly.
Like the more, the merrier, you know what I'm saying? You want more people on. And, piece of advice I gave him was, you know, obviously the teams that come at you earlier are the ones that really want you.
Yes.
So that's a huge part of the reason I chose Iowa State myself. But, you know, with that too, you get to kind of see if they really want you. So are they courting you in the process? Like, are they talking to you? You know, they checking on you the whole nine. So, you know, I'm, you know, kind of teaching him about the journey, but I want him to go about it at his own, you know, at his own pace. I don't want to dictate nothing. Obviously, I want to know where they're calling to go, but I want to build up this, you know, we're trying to break generational curses around this thing.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? See if we can't get some kind of hype popping for this NIL stuff and, you know, make it all make sense, man.
I mean, you doing your thing, man, with them. You know, that goes back to our conversation when we started in the football season about not treating your son any different and him out there, you know, getting recognized for the work that he's putting into it. So shouts out to you for, you know, instilling that in him. You know, we all try to do that into our kids.
Yeah, okay.
So good job on that, sir. We appreciate you for what you're doing for the community out there too, with helping these young men, because they all need a sponsor. They all need an advocate out there in the world for them, because, you know, we don't want them to fail. We don't want them to be a statistic. You know, we want them to be good contributing members of society.
For sure.
So
I say 100% congratulations to the young Malachi, for sure. I mean, that leverage is what the leverage is, and your path is what your path is. I mean, we know we got the legacy with Pops at Iowa State, but I mean, if Iowa State don't get off the horn. But like he said, generational curses trying to be broke around here. We got three letters we trying to get young fellas to.
Yeah. Right now.
They giving away checks nowadays. Man. Giving away money.
It's
so
weird. It is weird with this that is coming out there. It changes things a little bit. Like, you
changes
know,
a lot.
Like, so then let's go back. In y'all days, if NIL was around,
I would have stayed my senior year.
Okay.
Without a doubt.
Okay. And why you were so what would be your reason behind that?
Well, I left because my parents' house burned down, and actually burned down in February, and no one, this is, you remember, you know, we so old school that we had cell phones were just not coming out.
Yeah.
Like we used to have that phone plan in the dorms where it used to be like 10 cents a minute. We thought we was balling being able to call to the crib. So yeah, nobody called me.
Was it like 7 to 9 with your hours?
Right. So nobody called me and let me know. You know, my mom and dad just let me focus on, you know, schooling and balling and everything like that. Of course, we had that good season. So I was just focusing on that. And so once we lost out, sat down, talked to my dad, and he told me what had occurred. They had actually moved out, of course, because the house had burned down, and they were living in, you know, this little two-bedroom apartment with, you know, him, my mom, and my two brothers. And so, like, then at that point, it was just he had already spoken to Coach Eustace. Eustace had already known. Coach Eustace already known. And so, like, Eustace literally wouldn't let me stay. He was like, it's, you know, the time is now. You got to go. But, you know, I wanted to, without a doubt, come back. We had the same team, you know, for the most part. But I would have come back. The NILs was in place. Please, I would have been trying to get my COVID year, all of that. You know what I'm saying? If I can grow up, you know what I'm saying, in school and make hundreds of thousands like they doing now, some of these kids making millions, man, please, I would have stayed right in school.
Yeah, get some instant change.
Instant change to
the kids and their families, man. Did you see the Rashida kid that turned down that Florida, the deal that he turned down with Florida?
I saw that.
I didn't see that. What was that?
the man was getting, let me see, because I actually sent it to one of my boys.
Well, something happened, didn't it? Like, something happened with the deal.
I don't remember. So it was supposed to be 500K up front.
Jesus.
And after that, his payment would increase from $250,000 a month as a freshman to $291,000 a month as a sophomore, $375,000 a month as a junior. And if he stayed his senior year, it was like something like $195,000 a month, as long as he fulfilled his obligations. What?
Wow.
An 18-year-old kid.
Wow.
Like, so, yeah. Like, that whole breaking, you know, breaking these curses is real now.
Listen.
Just the opportunity. Yeah.
Listen, I don't know if it's his top three. I think it's kind of his top three. Bronny James. Mm-hmm. You know, talking about Bronny James. They got Ohio State, okay, USC, and Oregon. And so mm-hmm. me and my, you know, my brothers and cousins, we got a group chat, and they talking, you know, talking about it, whatever. And I said, he ain't going nowhere but Oregon.
Yep.
Well, and he's like,
you said it. That's the only thing I can think of.
I said, yeah, well, no. And one of my brothers, his dad is, you know, from Ohio. They got ties. I said, listen, his dad didn't even go to Ohio State. Nope. You know, you can see he's from Ohio. He gave them the love with Ohio State. He lives in L.A. right now, so he gave USC the love with USC. That connection with Phil Knight, his daddy and Nike, his freshman year, he going to have his own shoe. I guarantee you, they are already starting the renderings for it.
Easy.
Yep.
Easy.
Or it wouldn't make no sense but to go to Oregon.
It wouldn't make no – this the business of Clutch Sports not letting them go nowhere but Oregon, because he's not going to be his dad. We already know that. You know, he's maybe 6'2". He's – don't take anything away from him. He's a phenomenal player. His IQ is through the roof. He's not going to have the height as Bryce. Bryce has already passed him. Mm-hmm. Bryce is going to be more like LeBron than Bronny. But with that namesake, LeBron James Jr., he going to Oregon.
Yeah.
He going to Oregon.
He don't want to wear his dad's logo on his chest at Ohio State, for one. No. USC, yeah, he already –
I ain't thinking of that.
He don't want that. He wants to be his own. He's trying to be his own dude because he's already following the footsteps of his dad.
Right. You know, he got his name.
Yeah. And while we on his dad, shouts out LeBron, the kid from Akron. Yeah. Yesterday, I was watching me and Marcus talking about that before you got on, but I was watching the presidential address, and then turn right to that game. I'm like, it's like, I don't think he's gonna score 36 tonight. I'm like, he gonna score 30.
I seen when he came in with the all black Neo John on.
Was that a rayon silk? Like,
I don't know what he said. Rayon, man, they had rayon. I know when I saw that steel photo, what I was doing, I was in the grocery store. I said, I gotta get ready to get out of here because he finna go berserk.
Yeah, he finna go berserk.
I'm like, he's not going to do it. I'm like, okay, then 8 points in the first quarter. I'm like, okay, that's eight. And then he got 12.
He got 12 in the second.
That's 20 in the
first.
That's
20.
Quarter. I'm like, damn it, I lost. I'm like, right. He going off in like the second, in the third quarter. And like, getting
he it. He didn't play the fourth, did he?
Yeah. He played a little bit. He played a little bit.
Oh, did it? Okay.
Yep. Because they still wanted to win the game because they needed to win the game. But, you know, it's like, I saw. They were trying to get him them points off the bat. They weren't really playing basketball. It was kind of like Kobe's last game. They just get him the ball, let him do what he got to do. Kobe's last game, give him the ball. You know, it wasn't about basketball. It was about getting that first and then basketball second. Because Westbrook was throwing some passes. They were throwing some passes to LeBron. Who are you throwing it to? Throwing it to Jay-Z in the front row. What's going on? But shouts out to the King. I am not going to get into the GOAT debate. I am not going to get to that debate. That's all I've seen on Twitter. All my Chicago fans. You being from Chicago. This record hasn't been broken in 40 years. It's been almost 40 years since this thing. LeBron is a great player. I grew up in the era of Jordan. Jordan is, in my era, is the greatest.
Right.
LeBron is great. LeBron is right there. Yeah, I don't say, okay, he got to the finals and lost. It's a different game. It's a different world. I don't do that. They're both great in their own right. Don't compare them. Like, let them be great. Let these people be great. But like, when I was looking at it, the closest person to LeBron in this scoring title is Kevin Durant, and he has 24,000. So he still got to get another 14,000, and he's hurt accident prone.
Yeah.
And the top 20 are all retired. Like, so outside of Kevin Durant, they're all retired, and I think the next two, even in contention that's in playing currently is Harden and might be Harden and Westbrook.
Well, we know them two not going to get there. But I think who may have another chance to get close would be Steph. But Steph has some years. Like, Steph already in his 30s. Just it depends on, you know, his shooting load, how much he's going to, you know. But
speaking of Steph, did y'all hear the conspiracy theory about Steph and LeBron? That when they were born, they were injected with something because they both were born.
Born in Toronto, right.
And so they were injected with something to see what would happen. But like, it's just weird how people have these conspiracy theories. I'm like,
and they believe them.
And they do. You really believe them?
Hey, if it's on the internet, it's true. Y'all ain't know that. It's on the internet. It's true.
So it's true.
I saw a movie. A girl said that, like, in the classroom. She said, "I saw it on Wikipedia, so it's true." And the professor was like, "What? You know, you can change Wikipedia right now if you want to."
but that was phenomenal last night. And Kareem passing him on the ball. So it was good to see that, man.
People on Kareem, it was like, man, you know, Kareem in his first half saying, "I wish he have an ACL tear right now."
That was he did not look happy to be there. That's for sure.
He did the whole game. He was not irritated with the camera on. He just sitting there,
right, watching the clock. He watched the scoreboard more than Bron. Like, every time he scored, he looked up like.
So somebody posted, they're like, what if LeBron had a season-ending injury that, like, that night, like 2 points shy of it? I'm like, he will come out in the cast, stand there, and they will get the ball.
But it's the season, though. They're like, he's not retiring right now. He can add another 3,000 or 4,000 on top of this.
How many years do you think he got?
I thought last year, a little bit last year, year before last, he was about to start declining. Then he did something, you know, over this last summer. And, like, he's playing now. Like, he doesn't jump like he was in Miami, because he's probably about 15 pounds heavier than he was then. Yeah. But he's moving that way. So you can tell he's been doing a lot of elastic work. No heavy lifting or anything like that. His body is looking good. So he's averaging 30 at 38. It's LeBron James. If that falls, that can literally fall off to 14 to 18 points a game with him on the floor, and it's still productive. So even with that, you're going to see at least 43, 44.
He won't be. I don't think he'll be a top 10 player. I think he'll be a top 10 player for the next, you know, 3 or 4 years. Uh-huh. I think he will decline. Like, I think he's still going to do some things. You know, he's still going to be the top 5 player. He's always going to be there. But I think he's going to start to do his role playing and start to back up a little bit. I think, again, because like you said, he wants to play with Bronny.
Right.
That's kind of where he wants to do and see where that goes. But, you know, I'm going to start a rumor on his podcast. Yeah, he bought a Michael Jackson's hyperbolic chamber. So – that's been sitting in storage. So he bought that. That's
those are real.
But I know, but he bought Michael Jackson's, because Michael Jackson's is like, hey, Michael. You know,
Kendall Gill had one of those.
I mean, but he's
he had a hyperbaric chamber. Yeah.
But when you have the money like that, and you can get your training together, your nutrition together, like, you know, that made me want to go buy ladder protein. Cause I'm like, oh, LeBron taking ladder protein.
Right.
I mean, that's going to help me do something.
It must help me stay young or something.
It's going to help me do something.
And I tell people all the time.
Put his name on. I'm about to go buy me a tonal. hey, man, let me put this tonal in my house, you know?
I tell people all the time, I get it. They love to say, he spends $2 million a year on his body. He got some companies where he's getting tax benefits from that. We get it. It's house money. You know, yes. Drake bet $1.5 million on. Drake got $100 million in the bank. He could bet $1.5. Let me see the guy who, you know, got $1.5 million in the bank and he betting at $1.5 and then he's winning. Those are the type of people I want to see you talk about. Yeah. You know, when you got the house money and you got the money to do that, then it's just all the time. Some who have the money don't do that. You know, they take the money and go hang out with Lil Baby and all that different stuff. So it's a little different.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like right now, it's not even like those chips don't even have numbers to him. They're just chips. I'm here go five purple chips. Like they don't mean the same as when I go to Vegas or I go to the casino and I'm like, oh, that red chip is $5. I'm going more than that one. I'll put two of them out there, go 10 bucks. When you're playing with that house money, you can take some risks. But again, as much money as he has, you know, for this longevity, for him to like, you know, for his career, he didn't get hurt until like, what, 3 years ago was the first time like he really had a, like,
that groin.
That's where it's kind of started. But then he came back better. And like you look at it right now, 38 years old, all star next week. And he is still averaging 30.
Right.
20 years in the game, like you said, averaging 30.
He's averaging over 30 at the age of 38. And to talk about the record, like you understand, like us players, as NBA players, never thought that was going to be touched. We thought Kobe had a chance. The volume, how he scores, you know, we looked and was like, well, maybe MJ, then when, you know, MJ started declining or whatever, we knew but we thought Kobe had a chance. And then after that, Bron was so far behind Kobe at that time, we was like, we don't know. Then he started getting closer. The game changed and, you know, they started shooting more threes and all that different stuff. And his average stayed up there. And it was like, man, this might be a thing. And then as he got closer and closer, like the way his body looked, he's absolutely going to hang around until he does.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think, I mean, he wants to make everything untouchable. He's doing this thing, man. I mean, youngest to 10, youngest to 20, youngest to 30. You know,
right.
1,000, like every.
And people want to say, well, it's the longevity. But 5,000, 10,000, 15, every time they say these number of points, they say the youngest ever. So he was doing them quickly. It wasn't like he's been in here for 25, 30 years and now he's just not getting 15,000 points. And then another 20 years and now he got 20,000 points. He's the youngest ever to get to those numbers. You got to think it's going to happen.
Yeah.
Bro, we're up by three.
I know. And we were looking horrible.
We were
looking horrible. I thought, I was like, man, I do not want to do this podcast right now live during this game. I was thinking about it. Like, I'm like, man, can I cancel this tonight? But but 9 minutes ago and we up. It's gonna be a high scoring game though. But like that game last night. It was 76 to 66 or something like that at the end of the first half.
Yes. I saw that. They got 70 some points. I think they got 70 some points, and OKC is leading.
Yeah. Going into the All-Star game. It was an All-Star game.
Just running around heaving it up. Like, here you go. Give it back to Bron. Let's jack it up.
Man. So before we take our next break and actually talk about Iowa State basketball, you know, before I go play our ad for Brown Dogs Farm, I'll play that here in a minute. But just an update on, as we've been talking about football too, update on Brock Purdy. He will be having his surgery on the 22nd. In 2 weeks, basically, from 2 weeks from today, actually. He will be having that surgery. So we wish him well on that. I think he is going to have a Tommy John, right?
That's what I heard.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, and that's what we had, you know, and shouts out to Getty for getting on with us. But it was good to have Getty on here last week. And I texted him after we got done. He was like, man, that was fun. But good having him on here. And like, he couldn't talk about the injury because it's more of a baseball injury the way that was. But he was, you know, he gave us the insight of how he can get back and get better and, you know, how he got a strength chain that and his mental. So shouts out to Getty for getting on last week and Nurse and all that. So, you know, shouts out to that. But as we transition, we got one more ad to play before we get into this Iowa State basketball. 60-59 with 8:50 to go. And we want to get another message from our sponsor. So here's our message from Brown Dogs Farms. Take a listen to this.
Brown Dogs Farm are Norwalk, Iowa made hot sauces and dressings. Brown Dogs Farm was born out of the dream to emulate the simple life of Rob's grandparents, who inspired him with their hard work and abundant gardens. Rob and Amanda set out to create a unique blend of fruit and pepper that would satisfy the part of the brain that craves great flavor without sacrificing the spice of the peppers. Sweet, but still packing heat. With combinations like jalapeno green apple, habanero peach, cherry rhubarb reaper, and other great flavor combinations, there is a spice and flavor that is right for any party or get-together. BDF also has homemade versions of their classic and spicy ranch that are one of a kind. You can order all of those and more online at www.browndogsfarm.com and ask your local grocery to stock up.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So let's shout out to them. Just updates on them. April 14th to the 16th. They're going to be at the Middle of the Map Tattoo Convention at Hy-Vee Hall in Des Moines. So they'll be there all weekend serving up some good food. And then in 2023, this year, on Saturdays, they will be at the Downtown Farmers Market in Des Moines from 7 to noon. So check them out. Shouts out to them. When I get back, I got to get some more sauce. And so I saw a post on a little collie. I think they have like a little collie. He's a cute little dog they had on one of their Twitter or something like that. So I got the Brown Dogs connection. So no, shouts out to them. So thanks y'all for sponsoring us. Wanted to give y'all love there.
Appreciate it.
Yes. So Kansas, we lost to them by 2 when we shouldn't have lost.
No.
And then we came back and beat them the next time by 17, 15. But Kansas ain't, I mean, is Kansas the powerhouse that they were? I'm not taking away our win. I read a stat. I'm not looking at nothing on the screen. I read this stat and I remember this. Iowa State beat 4 ranked opponents this year. I think 4 top 10. And that's the first time in the whole era that a school has beat 4 top 10s in a season. So we just set history this year already. And Kansas lost a couple games, you know, go back and forth. This Big 12 is so damn tough. So tough. And, you know, right now with West Virginia, we're in the battle of West Virginia because ain't no slouches in this conference at all. Right. When they say 9 of us is going to go to 8 of us are going to go to the champion, to the tournament.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we beat on Kansas. You know, we had some, you know, we go back and forth. It's like we had these measures of greatness. We had these visions of greatness. And then we do something that just don't look right. So what y'all seeing? What you seeing, Mark? I mean, I've been hearing his name more. He's been doing a few things. Mm-hmm. What are you thinking about this?
Well, I mean, it is the Big 12. So, you know, to get a home win is definitely big. To get a road win is really, really tough. So I think I tweeted, I said, you know, at this point in time, we expect to beat Kansas. We don't look to beat Kansas. We expect to beat them. Not winning on the road in Lawrence, you know, was a tough loss, but everybody expected them to win at home, just like we expect to win at home. So the game against Kansas at home was definitely a good game. To see a blowout win like that, to see the guys playing extremely well, it was just a balanced attack across the board. Mm-hmm. But then, you know, we also have games where we're playing West Virginia, who has 3 wins in the conference, and we're down by 1 with 8 minutes to go. So yes, it's one of those things that you just got to, you know, go in and gauge, you know, how the wind blows when you step out on the floor. Not going to put it on the referees, not going to put it on, you know, rankings or anything like that, because that really don't matter at this time of year. You're just trying to get yourself in a position. I mean, we went to the Sweet 16 last year, not being ranked. So that's a big thing for us to be able to accomplish that. And we just got to finish it out.
Yeah.
Finish it out big time.
What you think, Brent?
I've been seeing a lot of, a lot of Tame Lipsy, man. I think he provides so much to us when he does decide to go. I know he had an off night. Was it against Kansas? No. was against
Kansas? He had like 9-8-8 against Kansas, something like that. He played well against Kansas.
It was one game he had an off night.
It was Texas Tech.
It was Texas Tech. So, I mean, just seeing him and his evolution is kind of – it's exciting to watch, but it's, you know, it's kind of promising too, because it's like the kid locks in and it helps us out quite a bit and home is coming along. But, I mean, that home and away, man, it's always tough to win on somebody else's court, as is. Yeah. Like you said, the expectation is to win at home. So, you know, we tend to kind of, you know, we bubble up a little bit at everybody else's spot. So, I don't know if that's an energy thing or a focus thing or what, but, you know, I know crowds always play a major factor in sports anyway. So, you know, being able to take them out of it some kind of way is always, you know, a perk for us. But so that's tough, man. it's tough to do anywhere you go. You know what I'm saying? But.
And when you talk about him, so he's averaging 7 points, 5 assists, 3.4 rebounds, 1.9 steals, and 2.1 turnovers a game. He's the only player in the country averaging those numbers this season, and just the 17th in the last 10 years to do so. So as the guard, as our guy with the ball, he is doing his thing there. So he's holding up his end of the bargain, you know, being a transfer in this new system, all this stuff. He's doing his thing. And so we shot him out because, you know, without him, you know, he shows these sparks. When I be seeing some of these sparks he does, I'm just like, okay, I like him. I like this kid. He's doing his thing. So
He's a true floor general. Like, he reminds me a lot of how Jock Vaughn used to be. Mm-hmm. You know, he gives us some flashes of him scoring it, but he's not a scoring point guard. He knows that he's a point guard. So he runs the ball club extremely well. He makes some great passes. He doesn't have the greatest length, you know. That's my workout alarm. I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing right now.
It's six o'clock for you, you know. Yeah. It's telling you to do something.
But anyways, he's a good floor general. He definitely, you know, take care of the ball, get us in the right position, things like that. You know, the upperclassmen try to rattle him a little bit, things, but he's very, you know, even keel a lot of times. The lights don't get too big for him. Kansas, Texas Tech, whoever, playing against Missouri, he's figuring it out in his first year of running the ball club, and he's done a lot better than I expected, you know, as a true freshman. Like, people don't, like, my freshman year, I know what the hell I was doing my freshman year. I was just hooping. Like, it wasn't nothing of a structure of a basketball player. And then when, you know, Floyd went to the pros and Larry Stacey came in and that coaching staff came in, they showed me the difference of being just a hooper and being an actual player. And there's so much technical stuff that you got to do to be locked in on. And I think he's going to make those tremendous strides between this year going into next.
Yeah, no doubt. You know, and hopefully he stays around and keeps performing like this, because we have what do we got next? We got Oklahoma State at home, and then we have TCU at home. So those are our next games, Saturday and then next week on Wednesday. So, you know, they're showing these lights. They're playing ball. I'm trying to look right now. You know, there's some bad calls. I mean, some bad plays, not bad calls, bad plays. But, you know, I'm proud of these boys this year being ranked going into the tournament. We're getting close. We got a month left of basketball before the Big 12 tournament. So, you know, we win this game tonight, we're still tied for number one in the Big 12. So, you know, this game means a lot to us. All the games mean a lot, actually, but this game means a lot to us. But I'm excited. I'm excited for this year. I'm excited for all the things that they are showing to us. You know, everybody was a little skeptical this year. They're like, we got too many transfers. We had a top six recruiting class this year. But again, it was a recruiting class. It was a lot of transfers, a lot of, you know, transfers in. So playing a new system, playing for a new coach, a lot of names that I was like, you know, I don't know who these cats are, but they're showing me who they are. So. You know, so it's hard doing a cast when we're trying to watch the game, because everybody, all of us looking back, you know, down a little bit. So
I got mine on my phone.
But yeah, I mean, this episode, people, you know, we glad y'all joined in. We've been on for a minute. You know, I got to go back to the kids, but we didn't talk a lot about basketball because not a lot to talk about because we're doing good. But we did talk about some personal things, talked about, you know, what we want to see. We did talk about, you know, our thoughts on some things, but we happy that you're listening to us. We're happy that we got our sponsors and Brown Dogs Farm and Revelton. We're happy that, that Ship and them are supporting us from the Three Beers Media, group. We want to shout out some of our other, you know, Hot Mess Happy Hour. If you haven't seen Ship, he has a 15-minute like thoughts of Ship every day. And so he's doing his thing on there, but we appreciate y'all listening to us. We appreciate y'all supporting us. Cyclones forever. Go State. We're gonna ride out to a little Sweet Caroline as we do it. But no, we appreciate it. So we'll holler at y'all next week. Do your thing. What y'all got to say out?
Be easy.
Be easy.
Be safe.
Where it began.